وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا.
You asked me a question. Can I ask you a question? Right. So, for example, Islam has been around for 1,438 years.
Yeah.
You accept that?
Yeah.
So now ISIS, Al-Qaeda and all these you mentioned, where were they before America and Britain invaded Iraq?
Well, if you want to look at other attempted caliphates, you might want to go back to the Ottoman Empire about 500 years ago, where the Ottomans were the one of the...
Are you comparing the Ottomans to ISIS and Al-Qaeda?
No, I'm not comparing the Ottomans to ISIS, but what I would say is they were attempting to...
Shall I read it to you?
Can you concentrate on ISIS and Al-Qaeda?
But you were asking me where were they?
Where were they?
ISIS's intention is to establish a worldwide Islamic caliphate, we've seen that before, have we not? That's my closest comparison.
You're saying ISIS was there before the invasion of Iraq?
Well, what I know is that there are multiple terror attacks weekly worldwide. Some of them in Pakistan, some in Afghanistan, some in Iraq.
You're not answering my question.
Why is it relevant? I mean, actually, you're correct that it's relevant in as much as when we invaded Iraq and removed Saddam Hussein, we removed a leader who was actually doing something about Islamic extremism, and he was keeping these people at bay. So these Islamic extremists existed, Al-Qaeda existed. Al-Qaeda has morphed somewhat into ISIS, okay, since the invasion of Iraq and the region, since the destabilization of the Middle East. We made a big mistake, and I think many people in this country were against the invasion Iraq.
So would you say that's political then?
Well, I would say Islam is a political religion anyway.
Right.
And I think that the desire to establish a worldwide caliphate has been there from the beginning. That's only my opinion.
Okay.
We've seen it with the Ottoman Empire. We've seen it since the invasion, obviously, of the Middle East.
Yeah.
I definitely think that created more opportunity for these people to operate in Europe and elsewhere. But I don't know whether the motivation is any different. Certainly, if your homes have been destroyed, that might make it easier for ISIS to recruit.
Right.
I think the ideology existed.
So if you take ISIS and Al-Qaeda compared to the 1.8 billion Muslims, are you saying ISIS and Al-Qaeda are better Muslims than 1.8 billion?
No, I just think that it certainly is an interpretation of Islam. So it's not just people blowing themselves up and stabbing people to death. There are other issues, I think. But in Islam, it's not my job to tell people what to do, but I can express concern, certainly, because I think, you know, Sharia law, for example, is fairly repressive.
What do you know about Sharia law?
Much as you, I predict. But I do know.
How do you know it has its
roots? Well, I know that it has its roots in the Quran, correct? And that it was established, and it's established in the tradition of Allah. And there are certain things that concern me, but it's just for the law, such as if you create a testimony, it's a testimony between a man and a woman. A woman's testimony is worth half a man, because a woman is less intelligent. Now, I'm
is that what he says, less intelligent?
Well, a woman's brain is half the size of whatever.
Is that what he says?
As far as I'm aware, that's what it says. As far as I'm aware, that's what I've heard. Now, please correct me if I'm wrong.
You're completely wrong.
Okay.
But what else? What else? No, what else?
And it'd be easier for you to correct.
What else? No, because I want to establish a point.
Well,
because
I think that's enough to be getting on with.
As soon as you mention Sharia law, people go to punishment. What else?
I'm just saying that all I'm saying is whether it's right or wrong, it feels at this juncture it's incompatible with Western law, for example.
Yeah.
So how could you have? I mean, obviously it's in everybody's best interest that people of all religions integrate together, can live together, side by side, work together, be friends, get married, etc. That's in everybody's best interest. But when I look at something like Sharia law, which seems to be an issue from the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad.
Are you a Christian?
And the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad. I see something which concerns me, principally because it's incompatible with our Western system. And I'm not saying that these people are wrong or that they're barbaric in any way, but there are certainly things about Sharia, of what I know, that concern me and that I don't think will necessarily work.
Give me an example.
point. So the one that I gave you obviously was with the with, yeah. from what I know of the region. The other one would probably be
today. I would like to repeat what I said to young Muslims.
I mean, for example, under Sharia law, you don't need porn, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, so we should be free to be wherever we want in this country.
As a Christian, do you believe that?
As a Christian, I think you should be able to be wherever you want, yeah.
Does the Bible permit you that?
I don't think that the law of the land should be linked to any religion. That's my point. You should be free to choose. So if you have a law in a country like Great Britain or France or anything else, that law should be secular.
No problem. Christian, which law is higher? God's law or man's law?
Well, Jesus said, give unto Caesar what is Caesar's, and give unto God what is God's.
So he said,
so you have to respect the law of the land that you're in.
If the law of the land goes against the law of the law, which one of God?
It sometimes can be a difficult choice. For example, if you're paying your taxes and you know that your money is being spent on immoral things, what choice do you have? Do you say, I'm not going to pay my taxes?
No.
No, you pay your taxes.
No.
So sometimes you have to disturb the law of the land.
The law of God says you mustn't eat pork.
In the Old Testament.
But did Jesus come to end the Old Testament?
Jesus came and he made obvious provisions, didn't he?
Which one?
When the woman was being stoned to death for adultery.
Yeah,
that was part of Mosaic law that would happen. He came along and he said, which of you is without the sin, cast the first stone. So he was actually a reformer. He was quite radical. Don't forget, he was put to death by supposedly his own people because he was so radical and he was changing so much. So yeah, he did actually reform quite a lot.
What did Jesus say in Matthew 5:17?
Tell me.
He says, I have not come to destroy the law or the prophets.
Yeah, you don't destroy something, do you? You can reform without destroying.
I have not come to destroy the law or the prophets.
Yeah.
But I've come to fulfill it.
Yes, but you don't have to destroy something to reform it. That's the common misconception, that you have to totally rip something down in order to reform it. You can maintain the structure of the law. You can maintain the traditions. But you can add to it. You can reform it. With our law, for example, constantly evolves, but no one would say, oh, you've destroyed it.
Well, example of the pork. If the Old Testament in Leviticus tells you not to eat pork because it's an unclean animal, and Jesus, according to you, says you can eat it, is that destroying the law or reforming it?
I think it's reforming it. It's updating it. Because these laws, especially in Leviticus...
Is the old law destroyed then?
Well, they're rewriting it. He's reinterpreting it, or he's...
He's destroyed it.
He may have destroyed a law, but he hasn't destroyed
the law.
He
said, I have not come to destroy the law.
Yeah, the law.
Then he says, not one jot or tittle shall pass away before this is fulfilled. And anyone who teaches man the least of this...
So what you're saying is that Jesus pretended he wasn't destroying the law, but he did?
I'm telling you what. Jesus in this verse is telling you, I have not come to change anything that was brought to you before.
Sure.
The law is Moses.
He did though, didn't he? He did. Yeah. So obviously you're taking him out of context or misunderstanding.
No.
Because his actions were self-evident.
The ones
his
he changed.
His actions did change laws and reinterpret laws. Yeah. So whatever you think he was saying at that point clearly wasn't what he was saying.
So how do you
and
know?
My interpretation is quite possibly closer
right.
So to the truth.
The ones.
Maybe
no, they're not. I'll tell you why. See, the ones he changed, he told you about. But he said of the old, an eye for an eye and all this,
yeah.
I'd say to
yeah,
you.
Yeah, yeah.
But he said of the old.
Precisely, so he told us about it.
He told you about it.
Yeah.
The ones he didn't tell you, you cannot guess that he's changed them.
No,
for example,
the
pork.
He did say.
Show me where he said you can eat pork.
He did say because he said that there are, I can't quote.
That's why
he said. But I know for a fact that at some point when he was speaking to his disciples, he gave them food and he said that it was good to eat. And that is taken to mean, because obviously the Bible has been handed down, written down, and then further, I don't know if it works the same with the Quran, but further interpreted and taught to us by our religious leaders. And there's a passage where he says that certain things are good to eat, and that has evidently been passed down to us by our religious leaders to mean you can now eat pork, or you can now eat shellfish, or whatever it is you can eat the pork.
There is nowhere in the Bible that allows you to eat pork.
But we listen. We yeah. don't. We don't say, especially not in the Catholic Church of which I'm part.
You're Catholic.
Yes. Yeah, so we take our teachings from not only the Bible, but from the Church as well. So the early Church Fathers will have interpreted passages of the Bible, and they would have also put those into, you know, laws within the Church. So, you know, Christianity works quite different from Islam. I think that might be the mistake you're making, interpreting the workings of Christianity as being exactly the same as Islam.
What I'm doing, I'm looking at your Bible and looking what your scholars have said about the verses. I'm not going to Islamic sources. I'm going to scholars like Barker and Bruce.
Sure, but I don't know whether you fully understand the whole structure of how the church works, because the early church was the Catholic Church.
Of course, the Bible they had had 70 books.
When the Bible was put together, I think in the 2nd or 3rd century, they weren't just teaching
in the
specifically
fourth century.
From the Bible, from the 4th century. They weren't teaching specifically from the Bible. They were giving interpretations as well. And they were, and look, some of it is, you know, we are all humans at the end of the day.
So
some of the interpretations that we give are not exactly perfect. But we're using the Bible as a guidebook. And we are trying to teach from it.
Sorry, what's your name?
Aaron.
Aaron, Elias, nice to meet you.
Elias, nice to meet you.
What I'm saying is, taking the Bible, what you just said is a valid point, that we are human, we are subject to fallibility, we may make mistakes. This is one of the reasons, Islam doesn't have a single head.
Yeah.
But the only person that can interpret exactly what the message is the messenger who brought it. Yeah, going back to the Bible.
I personally think that that's a mistake.
No, going back to the Bible, for example, this is why you're Catholic, your book has 73 books inside it. Protestant has 66.
Yeah. Well,
because it's interpreted by men.
You have 66, and then the rest would be...
Then there's 83, then whatever.
Yeah.
So this difference comes out from differences in opinion between men.
Certainly, yeah.
Right. For example, let's say Jesus... Let's say Jesus authorized the Catholic Bible. Then Protestant will have no arguments. It's authorized by Jesus. However, the Bibles you have...
But Jesus left us with the Holy Spirit.
The Bibles you have...
We have a relationship with God in Christianity. We talk to God.
Do Protestants have Holy Spirit?
We can be guided by God.
Do Protestants have Holy Spirit?
Well, I'm not. That's a very difficult theological question you've asked me. Because
it's that simple.
I don't always think that there's one specific way that you need to live out your Christian life. But Jesus has to be at the centre. And I think the Catholic Church has helped a lot of people. There are other churches that have done good as well. I'm not the authority myself.
I'm still on my spiritual journey
as well.
Yeah.
I'm aiming to learn more about the Bible so I can have better conversations with people like you. I'm aiming to learn more about the Quran so I can have better conversations with people like you. So you could say I'm at the beginning of my journey.
But at this juncture,
I like having these conversations because I'm of the opinion that the Quran is wrong. I'm of the opinion that the Bible is right. But I enjoy having conversations with people like you because you're able to either reinforce what I think or put me onto a different path to really look at it myself.
But then what I tell you, that you said the Quran, in your opinion, is wrong. Obviously, you're entitled to your opinion, but you cannot come to that conclusion without having looked into it.
No.
Does that make sense?
No, but that's my presupposition. That's where I start from. Because I've had real, genuine spiritual experiences as a Christian. Now, I feel I've come to a point in my life where I really need to investigate the Quran.
Yeah.
I'm at that stage where, you know, I've... And the Bible. So I need to learn the Bible.
But Aaron, I'll tell you something. If you come to a matter with a pre-assumption about the matter, would you be objective in that matter?
No, you wouldn't. But
this is what I'm saying.
But that's where I don't think anybody can necessarily be truly objective because you were brought up
fair
a Muslim.
That's a fair point. Yeah.
I was brought up Christian, but
you'll have some bias.
Praying for the grace of God and saying to God, please help me, you know, interpret this. Yeah. If I read the Quran and I feel the Spirit of God talking to me, then that would be what, you know, that would be something I'd have to think about. And if I read the Bible and I start to doubt, that's something I have to think about. But I feel like I'm on a journey. It's important for me to lay out what I know, talk to you about Sharia law. You tell me where I'm wrong.
I'm not an expert on Sharia law.
No, but you certainly know more than I do. Yeah.
But for example, I'll tell you something. Where do you take your information? Obviously, this is an obvious question. I want to establish it first. your information about who Jesus was is taken from the Bible, not from the church.
It's taken from a couple of things, because Jesus gave his teachings. Some of the teachings that Jesus gave, I feel to be self-evident, so I can see them around me.
Yeah, but where do you take it from? Where do you take it from?
I suppose primarily the Bible.
That's what I'm saying.
Primarily the Bible.
If anyone comes now, for example, anyone comes to you and says, "Aaron, I'm a prophet," what would you say?
Prove it.
Ah, excellent. Now, your proof is your Bible. So now, if you come to me, Allah says in the Quran, "Qul hatu burhanakum in kuntum sadiqin." Say to them, "Oh Muhammad, bring your proof if you're telling the truth." And your proof is the Bible.
Yeah.
Now, if you analyze the Bible, do you believe that the Bible is the inerrant word of God? Every single word?
I believe that it has been, men wrote the Bible, inspired by God.
Course, yeah.
Yeah. So, but that's the important thing, is it's written by men so we can relate to it.
Okay.
So there will be
God
some...
didn't sit and write,
so
we agree.
We can see that, you know, the account will be written down and there may be things that have been left out or things that have been added. But because we have four different accounts, we can read those and we can come to an understanding of who Jesus was. I don't know whether a man inspired by God or not could ever write an account that was 100% infallible, or would you want him to? Because human beings wouldn't be able to relate to it, in my opinion. There has to be some fallibility in human writing. There always is.
No.
Humans are not God.
I disagree with you.
Humans are not God.
If it's from God, for example, in the Quran...
Human can never be infallible.
No. But God can be. Agreed?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
So in the Quran, chapter 4, verse 82, Allah says, "Do they not ponder the Quran? If it was from any other source but Allah, they would find in it many contradictions."
Yeah.
Right.
People do say there are contradictions in
such
the Quran,
as,
don't they?
Such as.
Well, no, I'd say people say there are contradictions. Well, like, not necessarily contradictions, but things that self-evidently are not true, such as what I said before, where Muhammad decreed that a woman's intellect was half a man's. You said that's not true. That's what I heard. Somebody also, this is all from hearing it from elsewhere, by the way, that Muhammad rode up on a winged horse and cut the horse in half. So people say, well, actually, that doesn't make any sense, that Alexander the Great followed the sun and found it.
That's not Alexander the Great. Let me address them.
You know, it just doesn't make any sense.
Let me address them so you understand from now. Right. You know, when Muhammad was taken from Mecca and taken to Jerusalem by God, and after he came back, people were saying to his best friend, Abu Bakr, "Listen to what your friend is saying. He's claiming he went to Jerusalem in one night." Do you know what Abu Bakr replied?
Well,
which is my reply to you now. He says, "Revelation comes to him from the heavens. I believe that. And I don't believe God is able to take him to Jerusalem."
Yeah.
You believe that God...
And that is part of Christianity as well, you
listen,
know, that faith.
Let me finish.
Yeah.
You believe that God raises the dead. You believe God gives life, takes life, and all this.
Certainly,
but you cannot believe that God can take his messenger from one place to another.
Well, no, I mean, I don't believe that the Quran is the word of God.
But do you believe God can do that?
Yeah, I believe that God
so
can
what's
do
the issue with this?
To do. But I believe also that he would have to put within the Bible, if it was true, all the Quran, that things that are self-evident, you know, points that are self-evident.
Yes, God.
Not just rely on miracles alone. Miracles are one side. Miracles are one side. But there are teachings that need to be self-evident.
Right, the murky water. It wasn't Alexander the Great. It was another Alexander. In Arabic, it's Iskander.
All right.
But there's like 1,000 years between them. Well, what Allah says, he marched from the east to the west until he came to a place where the sun set in the murky water. Right. This is an this is the problem. The Bible and the Quran are Eastern books being translated by Westerners. Right?
Hello, nice to meet you.
This is the issue.
I was looking for you.
The Bible and the Quran are Eastern books translated by Westerners.
Yeah.
Right. This is a prime example.
Let me finish.
This is a prime example of where you get lost in the translation.
But why would God allow that to happen?
No, hold on a second.
If you're saying God wouldn't allow mistakes to be
it's
put
not
down
mistake.
By
this is
by
a, this
Christian
is a problem
writers.
For you.
Why would?
This is a problem for Aaron, the Westerner. It's not a problem to the Meccan Arabs to whom it was revealed. Let me finish.
If God wants it to spread, if Allah wants it to be a worldwide religion, surely it should translate well.
It does translate. Do you watch the weather?
Yeah.
Do you watch the weather? So when the weather person, male or female, tell you tomorrow the sun will rise at 7:30 and set at 7:45. Does the sun rise?
The sun doesn't rise, no.
Does it set?
No.
Why do you not phone the Met Office and say, hey, hold on a second, you made a mistake?
Because that's a well-established idiom within our language.
Thank you very much.
It's a well-established idiom.
That's an idiom in that language.
It's a well-established idiom, which, if you were going to translate it into another language, would have already been well-established and people would understand it.
No, it wouldn't.
It would.
It wouldn't.
Yes, it would.
It wouldn't be.
Or you would translate it in such a way that they would understand. So but if the Quran hasn't been translated in such a way that we can understand it properly.
Translator or God?
Well, I would say both.
How is it both?
Both, because if God wanted the translation to be faithful, then could he not have inspired the translator too?
Let's be fair here.
Yeah, so we don't have any faithful translations of the Quran in English.
There's no issue
in Arabic. What chance do I have? I don't speak Arabic, though. So how can you expect me to just take your word?
You ask me a question. Let me answer. Allow me have a chance to answer. When you said, how can you expect me to understand the Arabic? Don't ask the translator why you're not translating it properly. Nothing to do with the Arabic.
Yeah.
The Arabic is perfectly clear. What that means in Arabic, there's no more land. It's water. What it means, he came from the east until he saw the sun setting in the water. What does it mean? There's water in front of them, there's no land. The Arabic, the Quraysh had no issue. It was revealed in Arabic because Muhammad was an Arab, messenger to the Arabs. From there,
So the translation that says, was it muddy puddle? Or muddy water?
They should have explained in the translation, this is an idiom, meaning there's no more land. He came to the edge of the water.
So do you accept then that it's difficult for people who only speak English to accept the Quran as the word of God? So because it's riddled with idioms that don't work?
No, it's the part of the language. Who was the Quran revealed to initially?
Who was the Quran revealed to initially? You say Jesus, yeah?
Not Jesus. Who was the Quran revealed to
Quran.
Initially?
Yeah. Are you talking Muhammad here?
Yes.
Yeah.
And to the Arabs.
But
for example,
didn't Allah reveal things to Jesus, apparently, according to Islam?
That's Injil, not the Bible.
The Injil, yeah. And so how does that relate to... Is that prophecy, or...?
No. Jesus was before Muhammad.
Yes, so what is it exactly? Prophecy. Is the Injil prophecy of Muhammad, or is it prophecy
There's prophecy of Muhammad, yeah. But for example... Okay, we move to another point. Jesus, the Injil that the Quran talks about, has nothing to do with your Bible you have today.
So, but who wrote the Bible then?
This is the question that your scholars are asking. But I'll tell you something. Did Jesus see Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John? Did he see these Gospels?
Did Jesus see them? No, because they were spoke about him, weren't they?
Yes.
And so Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, when they came to the end of their lives, they needed to write it down for posterity. For eternity.
They were written
some years after Jesus died. But prior to that, they had travelled around speaking and telling people the gospel of Christ, spreading Christianity that way, and then before they died, they felt a need to write them down. So that is the way that works. Because you wouldn't write it down.
Were they inspired by God?
Well, they saw, didn't they? They saw it with their own eyes.
For example,
they were there. They were the apostles.
One thing that I keep hearing most Christians make a statement of is that if we were to write about an incident, we won't all write the same thing.
Yeah. That's probably true, especially like 30 or 40 years after the event.
But then you would expect the vital information to be included, would you not?
Yeah, I mean, I think you would. I mean, I don't have a problem with the way the Bible's written. I think the vital information
Why
is
did
included.
Paul miss out the divine birth of Jesus?
Why did Paul miss it out? I think it's because Paul's gospel was written possibly for a different purpose. You've got four gospels, and many of them are in a similar... I think Paul's is the one that differs more than the others, isn't it?
John?
Leaves out John, rather, not Paul. John.
Yeah, John.
Matthew, Mark, and Luke, kind of...
Synoptic.
And then you have John. But, I mean, there's a lot of scholarly discussion about why that is written in that way, why they're included, why certain gospels possibly were left out. But I think that the message that those four Gospels carry allows us to live our lives according to the way
they're
Jesus
not the same
is.
Message though.
But that's it, that's important. They carry the message that they carry allows us to live a life inspired by Christ. So I mean, you can, if you like, look at them forensically, but I think that the purpose that they were sent to serve, they serve that purpose.
All the I statements, for example, and every time you ask a Christian to prove from the Bible the divinity of Jesus, two sources are taken, Paul or John.
Yeah.
So all the I statements, most of the I statements of Jesus are in John. If Jesus uttered these words, I am the Father, the One, I am the Way, the Life, I am all this, why did the other Gospels not record them?
Why did the other Gospels not record the I statements?
Yeah, they're important to your salvation.
Yeah, they are important. And I think if Paul has recorded those statements, and the other Gospels haven't, and we
John,
have those...
John.
They have the, oh, sorry, John
yeah,
has
sorry.
Recorded those statements, and the other Gospels haven't,
yeah.
Then we have those statements available for us to read, correct? So if the people, the forefathers, who were putting the Bible together in the 4th century, thought to themselves, this doesn't look good, then surely they would have simply just included the Gospel of John and left the others out. They would have picked which one. They put together a selection of 4 Gospels that they felt carried the message of Christ the best.
So your statement suggests that the church fathers saw the future, that John will write these things.
How do you mean?
If they forecast the future, that John will come one day and write the I statements, because he was the last Gospel writer.
The Bible was put together in the 4th century AD, about 300 years, isn't it?
Afterwards. The Bible was never put together by anyone. It kind of evolved in a very conservative process over the centuries. There was never any definitive council in the early
one
church.
Sitting, yeah.
Apart from the Council of Hippo, but that was a regional
council.
The Council had nothing to do with the canon. That's
no.
A Da Vinci Code myth. But
oh, right, it's a Da Vinci Code myth.
No, seriously, he mentions that Da Vinci Code.
I'm going by what I know, okay?
That's fine.
And from what I know, I'm giving you the answers from what I know. They're put together. And a lot of what's in the Bible is self-evident. A lot of what you read reveals. I'm a Christian, yeah. It's a lot of what you. I'm Catholic, so I don't know how well that fits. It's rare that I ever get the chance to speak to Muslims. And as I was saying to. Ilyas. I'm just starting to investigate Islam. I'm just starting to ask these questions.
Yeah.
So you guys giving me your time and answering my questions is greatly appreciated, because for me, like I was saying to Ilyas, I come and speak to positions and I'm trying to discover the truth. At this point in time, I'm convinced that the Bible is the Word of God.
And they've been answered so far.
Yeah, and listen, Ilyas has got very good specific knowledge about the Bible. He's shown me that I need to be my knowledge. I need to certainly learn the things that he knows in order to speak to him about that. And I'm going to try and attempt to do
this. Aaron, you'll be surprised how little I know.
Well, it's all relative, isn't it? Well, but no, this is good. I think this is what is needed, because there is a lot of tension in the world.
I agree with your point.
Christians and Muslims seem to be, you know, ideologically completely separated, but when you actually talk to each other and you try to understand.
Can I recommend a book to you?
It's
It's called Islam Sheikh Ali Akhid. It's refuting ISIS, it's the title.
Okay.
And it goes through the laws, the understanding, historically speaking, about Islam, conduct of war, conduct of peace, what we do in states, our states, and other.
It goes through it, stage by stage,
and it's backed up by
quotes from the Hadith
and the Quran. And you can look up the quotes. Just try refuting ISIS.
Okay, yeah, I'll check it
genuinely,
out.
Genuinely, I swear to God.
No, it's interesting.
You should read it.
It's interesting, because then I
evidence earlier on from Bukhari Hadith? Do you know what I mean by Bukhari when I say that?
Bukhari.
Or Hadiths in general.
I know about Hadiths and the Quran.
There's a collection of Hadiths which Muslims in the world think is the most authentic.
Muhammad
forbade the killing of women and children.
That one attacks the century.
And there's another one there, he disapproved of the killing of women and children. And during his lifetime, Muhammad gave various commands to his forces concerning the conduct of war. And the most important of these is summarized by his companion, Abu Bakr, the first caliph. And this is what he says. Neither kill a child, nor a woman, nor an aged man. Bring no harm to trees, nor burn them with fire, especially those which are fruitful. Slay not any of the enemy safe for food. You are likely to pass by people who devoted their life to domestic services. Leave them alone.
Interesting.
When ISIS target, like they do on Westminster Bridge or something, women, children,
they blew up a mosque.
Violating the teaching.
I've got one more question.
They blew up a mosque.
One last question. And this is not having, you know, much knowledge of the Quran.
That's fine.
I understand that there are pieces of passages in the Quran such as that. Now, the information I've been given is that there are later verses in the Quran which advocate violence, which are, supersede the earlier peaceful verses. Now, just a quick explanation of that.
We don't believe it.
That's not true. In my view, what happened was this. When Prophet Muhammad, who was a town called Mecca in Arabia, he was called to be a prophet when he was about 40 years old. And for the next 8 or 10 years, I forget how many years it was, he spread the message of Islam covertly and then openly.
13 years,
because he was persecuted. His followers were persecuted. They were not permitted to fight back. Eventually, though, when many of them left Mecca, they went to a northern town called Medina. Permission was given to fight, but it says very clearly in the Quran: permission is given to fight, but do not be the aggressor. Permission is given to fight to those who have turfed you out of your home, who have attacked you and persecuted you. You can now fight them, but do not be the aggressor.
Okay.
So it's a defensive jihad.
This is something I'm certainly going to be looking up. And unfortunately, I cut you off because I've got to go. Are you going to be here like
most Sundays? We're here.
Because it would be good to continue these discussions and learn a bit more.
Bring some more questions.
I don't know.
As many as you can, actually.
Yeah, and I'm going to be doing my research. Don't put any of the bits on that made me look bad.